everyone, and thank you all for joining us today for our webinar series. We are going to be having an introduction to pre-employment transition services, or in, of course, this world, we call it pre-ets. And we are very fortunate to have Annette Jett and Haley Andes with us today with Build Inclusion. And we will get to them in just a few minutes. I am Stella Beard with Kentucky Spin, and I wanted to tell you all just a little bit about Kentucky Spin. But before I do that, I want to go over just a little bit of housekeeping. On the right-hand side of your screen, you will see what we call a dashboard. On that dashboard are a few things I want to point out to you. One is a place that says handouts. If you click on that little arrow going to the right and drop down that box, you will see today's PowerPoint that you can download anytime during the presentation, or later this afternoon, we will be sending out a follow-up email that will have the handout attached to it. So you can wait for that if you would like. Also, there is a box that says questions. And throughout the presentation today, if you have questions that you would like to ask Annette or Haley, please type those in the question box. And I have Michaela with us on here also, who is with Kentucky Spin, and she'll be helping me monitor some of the questions today. So without further ado, I want to go ahead and tell you a little bit about Kentucky Spin. We are the special parent training, or we're the Kentucky Spin is the special parent involvement network. We are the Parent Training and Information Center, or the PTI, for the state of Kentucky. We have actually been the PTI since 1988, and that was actually when Kentucky first received the PTI grant. So every state has a PTI, and we are actually mandated under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. And we're funded partially by the U.S. Department of Education. And what we do is we provide training, information, and support for children and youth with all types of disabilities, birth through age 26. We work with parents, families, and professionals. So we provide a lot of information for families who need those resources. Now, something we do not do is we do not act as attorneys. So we're not going to be giving families or professionals legal advice. We are not going to be telling them what they should or should not do. But what we do is we empower families to effectively advocate for their children. And we also provide peer support. And so with that peer support, we help families access needed information and resources. One of the things here at Kentucky Spin that I think is wonderful is all of our staff and consultants are either parents who have a child or an adult with an intellectual developmental disability, or we have a disability ourselves, or we're a sibling of someone with a disability. I myself have a son that's 24 who has an intellectual disability. So I have been doing this and been involved in special education for many, many years. This slide here, we have shown at pretty much all of our webinars when we first started doing them back in March. I mean, literally when the pandemic hit, we went to a virtual platform pretty much the very next week. And we have been doing webinars since then every Tuesday and Thursday, providing an alternate way for families still to get training and the resources that they need through all of this. But it says, together we can accomplish great things for our children. None of us have all the answers, but we are all working through this pandemic and adjusting as we go. And I know that a lot of us feel that way, and we've all had to make a lot of adjustments. Well, I'm very excited to have Annette Jett. Annette is the Executive Director of Build Inclusion. And we also are fortunate to have Haley Andes. And Haley, you can tell me if I'm pronouncing that right. She is the Associate Director for Build Inclusion. So ladies, if y'all want to show your faces so we can see you all, that would be great. There's Annette and there's Haley. Yay. It's so great when it actually works. And can you all hear me okay?
Yes.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Okay. I'm going to pull up your PowerPoint, Annette, and we will get started with the presentation. Are y'all doing okay today?
We're doing great. How about you?
I'm all right. I'm all right. Okay. Let's see. Can you see your PowerPoint now?
Yes.
Awesome.
Yeah, so we'll just start here. Stella's going to be moving the slides forward. So if there's any delay between the way we're talking and the screen that you see, hopefully we can fix that. This just basically talks about our mission statement, and Build Inclusion turned 5 last March, right after COVID restrictions hit. And so we will be 6 this March, and we're a nonprofit, a 501c3. We were developed by multiple parent advocates and a couple of professionals in the field. And we are driven by high expectations, and we expect that of our students and job seekers and the people that we serve. And we worked with community leaders, advocates, families, teachers, schools, to promote intentional inclusion and increase opportunity and access. I think that one of our main points is that access is key. If we don't have access to education or to employment or to community or to recreation or to housing, that's where we get into a little bit of trouble. So we want to help increase that and have done that over the last 6 years. Go to the next one. So this is part of our, this is our tagline, is to employ, educate, and engage. And when we first started, we really put a strong focus on the educational aspect of disability. And I'm actually responsible for that, because at the time, you know, my daughter was young and she was in elementary school. She is now almost 16, and she's in 9th grade. And so we are entering the world of transition, and yes, so not only as a provider, but as a parent, I take these topics and you know, try to look at them from multiple different sides. And Haley has been instrumental in helping us. She's been with us almost 4 years now, and was the first other employee that I hired after me being on. What we did with this, though, our timeline, is that we realized that we started out in the education area, like I said, and it was just a linear timeline. But once we started employing people in the public, we realized that's how you educate the community about inclusion, and that's how you engage people with disabilities into integrated settings. And so it really has to happen. We can't just sit around and talk about it all the time. And so I think that this has been something that was really eye-opening for us and has changed the way we think about everything. You have anything to add to that, Haley?
No. I think the tagline used to be kind of linear, and we've created it more in a circle because it all works together and it has to continuously happen. That's the only thing I wanted to add. So
we had realized early on that there was a gap in the system when it came to transition age students. And I, you know, in studying what we were going to do, how we were going to do it, we understood that there was this significant, like if people came out of high school and just had nothing to do, that they were more likely to be unemployed as they got older. We looked at national core indicator studies and that kind of thing. They might not have relationships outside of the family or paid caregivers and that type of thing. So we were going to focus on that transition age student, and we were going to help families get to that point, and that they understood what was available for them. So shortly after we had decided that and had really, you know, started putting that to work, the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act had been signed into law, but it was pre-employment transition services was a piece of this that ended up coming around in, I think it was January of 2017, with the final regs came down there. And it was really just designed to help people access employment, education, training. It wasn't only for people with disabilities, but there are some disability specific laws sections within this regulation. So if you want to go to the next screen, I'll kind of break this down. This is how PREZ came to be. So section 110 of this required that a state spend at least 15% of the allotted budget made available through the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation. And at the time we had an Office for the Blind. Now they're more together, and there's a division of blind services. And 15% of the entire state budget was to be spent on pre-employment transition services for potentially eligible students. Okay, so potentially eligible means age 14 to 21 in a school setting. So the school setting is a little bit, I mean, it can be an actual high school, it can be homeschool, it can be a vocational training program, it can be college. So there's multiple different interpretations of that. If you're on here and you're a parent, you go, oh no, my kid, you know, just graduated and they're 22, they don't have a chance to get in. There are ways that adults and people that are working through the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation can also still access these services. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. We actually do serve a number of people that are outside of that age group, all the way up until about 30, and offer them pre-employment transition. In Kentucky, this budget, and this was these numbers come from December of last, not this past year, but the year before, that was about $8 million. So that's a lot of money that's going toward these services and to help your students and your young adults learn about how to integrate into the job market. You got the next one. So section 113 was defining the five required activities known as pre-employment transition services. Okay, so the five activities, and we'll go over these in detail after this, and I'll have Haley explain this a little bit more to you. But if you want to go ahead and tell them about the five right now, Haley, and what we're going to do is we're going to talk further about what self-advocacy really is and get into some of that. So if you want to talk about some of the other ones that are on there, that's fine.
Yeah. So yeah. There's self-explanatory. So that's just simply exploring jobs that are out there. And there are certain ways that we do that at Build Inclusion. Workplace readiness training. So that's kind of your soft skills or hard skills. So communication, resume building, interviews, that type of stuff. Self-advocacy, then work-based learning experiences. So that is when a student can actually go to like a work site and kind of get some of that. So think of it maybe like an internship, but not necessarily. It's just learning different work skills on a job. And then there's also college counseling. So that could be helping in finding colleges, exploring what college looks like. If people are in college, maybe help them in learning how to organize or pick out classes and explore those types of things. So all of PRET's pre-employment transition services are focused around those five topics.
So, and I believe the college counseling is actually the terminology in the regulation is post-secondary counseling. So that could be like a vocational school. It doesn't have to be your traditional four-year college when you're thinking of that. But there's a lot of things to work out sometimes. Like sometimes people need organizational skills, or they need to figure out their transportation or where they're going to go, what classes they're going to take. So we can help do that. These can be offered in Kentucky on an individual or group basis. We have found that doing group classes really is the easiest way to help people feel comfortable and start opening up. And we've done it for many years. We actually did it before the final regs came down through grant funding. And it was just kind of difficult to get somebody to sit in the room one-on-one with you. Sometimes their parent would be there, sometimes not, and kind of just open up to the process. But when they're around their peers and other people, it becomes much more natural. So if you go to the next one, Stella, this is talking about section 511. So if you know somebody that has been in a sheltered workshop or a place that has a 14C certificate, they are now going in and each year and discussing that there are job options available and making sure that the people know that. They've also stopped allowing like just a school to workshop experience. You have to have a much documentation that says this person can't work in a competitive integrated setting because of this, 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 and that. we find that most everyone can work given the proper facilitation and knowing what or the proper environment conditions and that type of thing. And that's why we spend a lot of time in the discovery process. But this kind of stopped that straight path that was happening quite often. And now many more people are choosing employment, and that's supported by vocational rehabilitation. There is a film about 511. If you are in this spot, there's a whole YouTube channel called Employment Files, and there's a lot of stuff done by HDI. We did some of the early videos there, and there is one on 511 as well. Go to the next one. So Haley talked about these five required activities that we're allowed to do. In Kentucky, if you do this in a group setting, you have to set forth to Office of Vocational Rehabilitation what your plan is, what your curriculum is, and that type of thing. And we have done that at Build Inclusion. We can talk a little bit more about that later in the open discussion. I find that a lot of these are easier than some others to offer. Work-based learning experience has kind of been put on hold to a degree because we're doing virtual services right now through the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation. So we haven't really been able to take people out and do those kinds of things. We've had to become really creative. But self-advocacy is a piece that I think is more difficult than the others to teach because it's harder to understand. So we're going to go into the next screen and we're going to talk about this a little bit more. Are you there? Let's see. Trying to follow around along. Okay, so what is self-advocacy? You can go ahead and read that out loud, Haley, if you don't mind, please.
Self-advocacy is learning how to speak up for yourself, making your own decisions about your own life, learning how to get information so that you can understand things that are of interest to you, finding out who will support you in your journey, knowing your rights and responsibilities, problem solving, listening and learning, reaching out to others when you need help and friendship, and learning about self-determination.
Okay, so basically self-advocacy is thrown around a lot, the terminology, and self-advocates is used a lot in talking about people with disabilities. And we really feel like it is a skill. It's not something that should just be taken for granted that people have. And actually, most students that I know that are in high school, I also have a son that does not have a disability, but I think that most students can benefit from these self-advocacy skills. It's not just for people with disabilities. But self-determination is really the biggest piece of this. We break it down into four different things, and we'll explain this further. But I want to go in a little deeper to what self-determination is and why that's as important as it is. So if you'll go to the next slide, Stella, please. Okay, so self-determination is really about goal setting and mapping a plan to how you're going to get to the next spot. Research shows that self-determination has a strong correlation to positive post-secondary outcomes in the areas of employment, independent living, and community inclusion. So even in education, I mean, if you are more self-determined, if you have kind of a plan in place, if you have a goal set and you have your support team and that kind of thing to get you there, to help get you there, then you have a much greater chance of success in other things that you are going to try to pursue. So if you go down to the next slide, this is kind of the way we break it down. I mean, when we say it's a skill, you don't just all of a sudden wake up one day and you're a self-advocate. I mean, there's adult self-advocates. But really learning about self-awareness is the first piece of that. And you'd be surprised how many people that we work with that we do a lot of team building and a lot of, you know, things that require people making choices and being able to express what it is they like and what they don't like and activities that are around that. We make it engaging and fun because it has to be, or you're going to lose your audience. So learning what they really like, not necessarily what their parents like or what their best friend likes, you know, that becomes a real eye-opening experience. Once they do that, the self-esteem comes next, because if you know what you want, like, desire, need, you have to have the self-esteem to ask for that. And Haley does some, if you want to tell them about your adaptive recreation experience and how you use those activities to help people build their confidence, that'd be great.
Yeah, so I come from a camp background, but also my undergrad is in parks and recreation, but also therapeutic recreation. So I'm a certified therapeutic recreation specialist. That's a long title, so CTRS for short. But doing a lot of different team building activities, one, it helps break the ice in classes sometimes for people, and you see people really start to come out of their shell, which helps build their self-esteem when they're working alongside other people, and they build each other up, you know. And then you also see people who might really rise and become leaders in those positions as well. So doing different activities like that really help build people's self-esteem. I think also it focuses on a group aspect too. So it doesn't just put like it on one person necessarily, but it really can push people out of their comfort zone. And to be able to do that, and I feel like when you do that and you get pushed out, your self-esteem can grow if it's facilitated in the right way. So it's also all about the facilitation of it, and kind of knowing the boundaries of who you're working with too, and kind of what those expectations are. And you set those in the front of that too. I love team building activities. I think they are great. You can learn so many different things from team building activities, and it's all in the debrief of it too. So like, how do we communicate, and then how does that apply? So there's the application piece of that too. Because wherever people work or just in life, you're around people. And so learning how to work in a team and learning those different skills through that is a fun way to do that. So.
Yeah, and Haley's fantastic at that. And I would say that one of our strengths is that we've hired people that have very different backgrounds. And like she said, she came from a camp background. Actually, she was doing her practicum at Lexington Parks and Recreation, and my daughter was in one of her camps. And I thought, heck, if she can put up with me, she sure can. She make sure that. I mean, she can be effective in this field. And so I asked her to come and interview, and it's worked out well. She's since gone on to get her MBA, which means she is a very self-determined person. And if you want to go back just 1 minute, we'll finish up that slide, and then we'd like you to join on with us in the video portion on the next slide, Stella, if you would. So self-determination, like we touched on that, that's what comes next. You know, you've got the confidence, you know where you want to go, you know what you want to do. And it's not just even around a job. It might be like nobody's asked somebody exactly what is it you really want? What makes you excited? How do you see your life happening? So these are transferable skills that they're learning. And I don't know about you, but I know as a parent myself that when I have other people, my child reach or set their goals and talk about that kind of thing, sometimes they're more receptive to other people talking about it, because, and that's again not disability specific, that's just parent and kid specific. They will sometimes rise to the occasion when it's somebody else suggesting it or maybe really honing in on it. So it does help to have all the support that you can, and I've seen that over and over again in our own lives. And then after that, let's say you set goals and you start going for them. Well, you have to have a self-monitoring process in place. And if you don't, then there's a chance, you know, for failure. Everybody's going to have failures, and everybody's going to have things that they wish they could have done better. But if we can monitor that, then we know that we can reset the direction or the course by doing something differently the next time around. So I just think that's important. And again, important for all of us. But we spend a lot of time on this in our pre-employment transition services throughout the many classes and phases that we have. So if you want to go to the next one, and can you join us now, Stella? It's going backwards. Go the other way. There we go. Okay. So when Stella asked us to do this, you know, it was like, okay, are we just going to have a PowerPoint presentation and just talk to people? And we would rather have conversations and engagement because I feel that's where the learning comes. Because I can tell you all day long about pre-ed because we've been doing it for, you know, 4 years, and it's second nature to us. And Haley has become a super pro at it. But we want you to know how you can access this and how it can lead to success for your student or your child or the person that you serve. I know there's a varied audience on here today of parents and providers and perhaps other people that support people with disabilities. So in starting, the great Lou Brown, who was a founder of TASH, said pre means never. So does that apply here? So when pre-employment transition services came out, there was a number of people that have been around a lot longer than I have that have studied this a lot longer than I have and have delivered services longer. And they would say, oh, you know, that happened when sheltered workshops came around. That was initially created in 1938, and it was just supposed to be a precursor to people getting jobs in an integrated setting in the labor market. And it was created, I think, out of goodwill to make sure that people coming back from the war, you know, had a shot at getting a job, and they may needed a little bit extra experience to get back into the workforce, right? Or a little extra, you know, support. Well, what happened was it continued, and it just continued and continued, and then people spent their lives in that setting. I'm not criticizing that. I'm just saying that that's what happened. And so when we're looking at the social model of disability, which is, you know, it's not the person that's the problem. It's the access, like we talked about. It's the availability of services, the availability of support, just physical access and communication and perception and all of that stuff that fits into it. If we're trying to create a more inclusive world, then those congregated, segregated settings don't work. And they are not supported by voc rehab. They have not been in Kentucky for a long time. So there, that's treated more as an adult day program. So when we're talking about, you know, really concentrating on employment, we are a community rehabilitation provider. So back up to the first statement, does that apply here, the pre-employment transition services? No, not how we deliver it, because we have to an end. We want to concentrate on an outcome. And we have a saying in our office, it's not about the income, it's about the outcome, because if you're producing outcomes that are successful for people, the income's automatically going to funnel into your agency. And, you know, let's face it, if you're an agency out there and you're on the call, we have to have income to survive. And we have to, you know, if you're a parent going, you know, I don't want people making money off the backs of my kids, I get that. But at the same time, if we're able to offer quality support, we have to have a funding source. And so this has helped us to do that. This has also helped us to get to those outcomes that we want, because we start to get to know the student much sooner. We glean information. They know us. We know them. We know if it's a good fit, not a good fit. They know if it's a good fit and not a good fit. And I do want to express in here that there's always consumer choice. So like if you are with an agency and you're not happy with them, you always have that choice of changing agencies. You do have to go through some or picking your agency from the very beginning. And that's something that you would discuss with your VR counselor. But we are a community rehabilitation provider, and there's several in the state. They're called CRPs, and might offer a variety of services. We offer pre-employment transition services, traditional supported employment, and we are getting certified in, well, Haley and I are already certified, but the rest of our staff is continuing to get certified in customized supported employment, which is just a little bit more time spent with the person going into a job or a work place and really looking at what the tasks are there and maybe what could be unbundled or what's an unmet need. And then how could the skill sets of the people that we serve or the person that we serve fit that particular business. So it's very individualized. In July, we're going to also start offering IPS service or IPS employment to individuals. And that's a much quicker process. So we'll kind of have, you know, the benefit of being able to do the quicker process, the traditional process, and then also the, they call it rapid job search in IPS. Then the traditional supported employment or the customized. Love that because you really do get to know a student in pre-employment transition. And I feel like we're going to have a good idea of maybe what that person could benefit from. And then provide direction. We're not going to tell you which way to go, right? And we're not going to tell the VR counselor that, but we can offer direction if we have that kind of information. So what is the value in having a community rehabilitation provider involved in this, in the process of pre-employment transition? And I'm going to answer this and I'm going to give the next two questions to Haley. But if you have anything that you want to also add, Stella, please let me know. But there are many people that offer pre-employment transition services, and we'll get into that a little bit in the last slide as well. But there's people that are in your schools doing it. There are people from the educational co-ops. There are people from KCTCS and different people around the state that are doing it. The value that we have seen as a CRP is that we are the people that are going to follow the student after they graduate high school. So if you have already established that relationship with someone, or you are better educated on how the process works, how it can lead into supported employment. You do not have to have pre-employment transition services in order to get into supported employment. But I can tell you that your path to understanding it and your path to a your student or your consumer or your child is going to have a better path into finding something that is successful. So again, back to the top questions, if pre does not mean never, if, you know, it's kind of a means to an end, and that's what it is for us, or even a means to a beginning, because I would say that that's one thing Stella and I were talking about yesterday. It's like when you come out of high school, you don't have any experience. You're not going to get the management job probably like the first time around. I didn't. You know, you have to build your way up. And so we, the hope is that you find, you know, the skill sets that the person has, you find the strengths that they have, the interests that they have, and you get them engaged and get them working. And you continue to grow on that. And then it doesn't stop. They don't, like, if they get a job at, let's just say, you know, Kroger or something, that can be a beginning job just to get your feet wet. And then we can move on from there too. So that's not our goal. Our goal is to individualize it. But we have people that work in all kinds of different environments, from UK to hospitals to big box stores to small mom and pop shops, you know, and that type of thing. And there's benefit in all of it, in my opinion, or as long as it's the right fit for that person. Mm-hmm. So Haley, you can speak to the next thing on the COVID mm-hmm. restrictions. And we don't beget, you know, we don't beget the COVID restrictions. We think they were necessary, but it did lead to a lot of innovative thinking on our staff part, and I'm just so proud of what they've been able to do and how they've been able to deliver it. So you can take that one.
Yeah, COVID really changed how we do. We would go. I would go and just everything. Go to classes. I would have community classes.
Haley, but, I think you're having some pretty bad feedback. Do you have some headphones or something you can put in?
I will see if these work.
Okay,
while she's doing that, I'll tell you what she was saying is that we used to go into schools, we used to have community classes where people would come to our office, or we would go to a particular place where people could gather together. And it was really cool. And then COVID came and our offices closed and we stopped, you know, I mean, even schools closed, right? And then national guidelines from the Office of Voc Rehab also changed to the point where we needed to offer only virtual services. So, wow, that was a big change for pre-eds, because one of the things was this socialization piece of it. People would love coming to our offices. Are, do you think you can hear it now, Haley?
No, it's on all the headphones.
Okay.
But I'm trying.
Okay, so I'll just continue and then you pipe in when you can so that we can get through all of the slides. But anyhow, so what happened was we started doing virtual instruction or virtual classes, because we didn't want people to think, okay, we've forgotten about you. Some people had decided, wait, I don't want to get a job right now. It's too dangerous out there. It's too unknown. And we understood that, but we did not want to lose connection with them. And we didn't want them to lose connection with people that they had made friends with and that type of thing. And one of the really beautiful things about having those in-person classes was, in the beginning, there'd be many parents that would say to us, oh, my child's not going to participate in a group setting, or they don't really like to hang out with other people, or whatever it was. And by the second or third class, they're running up the steps to get to the office. Their parents are dropping them off early. They're coming in, they're playing cards first, and they're doing all of that kind of thing. They're exchanging numbers with each other. And so there was a real social aspect of it that also increased self-esteem and also kind of opened them up to a newer world. And at Build Inclusion, we don't separate out like by capacity who's invited to a class. We have very inclusive classes. You wouldn't know who has what type of disability, generally speaking. And that's important to us because we've gotten so much good conversation through that and participation and integration. So when that happened, our whole team started working on class content, because after a while, you couldn't just use the typical class content. Some of it didn't apply virtually. So we stayed on topic, but we started creating these new themes of the class, and people would divide it up. So we have, for instance, I told you we have a very talented staff. We have an expressive arts facilitator on our staff. We have somebody that's getting their music therapy degree. We have Haley, who has the adaptive rec and the business background. We have other people that do, have an MBA and job development background, and that's also my background as a business person. And then we have a clinical or a person that's graduating and going to be a clinical social worker. So we had all this talent and they came together and they did things around mindfulness and around, you know, around communication and around different ways to do it. And in the beginning, I got to say, it was a little rough, because you know how it's been at your offices, getting people to acclimate to Zoom, and doing that with multiple people in multiple parts of, you know, Central Kentucky, and with multiple different technology devices and that kind of thing. So it was a struggle. There's been some fun in it. We did end up even getting to have a virtual birthday party at the end of March, and that was fun too. So the staff has just been so creative in making these things, like from creating escape rooms where people would go into breakouts and they would have to, you know, answer questions and work as a team to get through it in order to get to the other side and get back, and who won first and all. And it was really just bragging, you know, rights. It wasn't any prizes at the end of the game, but it was bragging rights, and it was fun. And it taught teamwork, and it did all those things that pre-eds is supposed to do. It taught teamwork, it taught communication, you know, it taught, you know, you saw people rise as leaders, and you saw people that were better at, you know, just kind of following the rules and being more intense about it. Do you think your sound is working now, Haley?
You tell me. Is it?
It's better. Is it better?
I still hear feedback.
Yeah, it's still a little feedback. And okay. As much as I want to be on and show my face with y'all, I think when I come on, it's pulling the, you know, I'm living in the I live in the boonies, so I'm going to go ahead and hop off, but you all are fine. I think it's on my end.
Okay. Thank you. I just wanted to give you time to speak to this, but I think we've given a pretty good overview of how it changed the delivery, but we still have had an incredible response. Would you agree with that?
Oh, yes, most definitely. We still have people. I think you mentioned it. I know you mentioned it with our in-person classes, but we sometimes get on as staff a couple minutes early just to make sure, you know, we're good to go. And we already have like five people or so in our waiting room, like just waiting to hop on to the Zoom call. So we call it like the floodgates. We're letting the floodgates in to class so everyone pops up on Zoom. But I think everyone's become experts on Zoom in our classes that have been through them throughout the pandemic. It was a challenge in the beginning. I heard you talk about that a little bit. We would all be on like phone calls with people trying to get them on and stuff to the first couple of classes. But after that, I mean, it's very soothsailing. They all know how to use it and everything. So.
And so that was important. So the next thing is, how does this lead into successful vocational outcomes? So we told you we can start working with somebody as early as 14. And I will tell you, my daughter has participated in some of these, some of this work, even since she was in middle school, because she was 14 in eighth grade, and she was eligible, potentially eligible. Just means that you have a documented disability, an IEP, or a 504, and that you're in that age group. So it's very easy. I mean, you could have ADHD and qualify for these services. It's very easy to do that, or you could have a more significant impact of disability. My goal in you know, when Stella asked us to do this was, again, we want to see this going out to every student, because it is something that, you know, most people are eligible for. So in the very end, we're going to tell you how you can advocate for it in your community. We want you to know that we're always here as a resource. Even if we don't serve your area, we can probably help you find people that do. And if you are a provider, we could probably help you, you know, manage or help you in your setup of the actual process and program. So I have a few slides that I'm going to kind of just run through really quick that talks about how does this lead into successful vocational outcomes. So just stick with me, Stella, if you will, and go ahead to the next slide. And I'm not trying to leave you out, Haley. So hearing wise, if you feel like you're not
you're good
experiencing feedback, just let me know and then pop in when you can. So the benefits of pre-ETS. So at a minimum, a person with a documented disability is identified earlier and begins to receive services around employment. So it used to be that as a CRP, they would call us in the senior year, sometimes in the very last couple months or the last quarter, and we would go to IEP meetings or we would be referred somebody and we'd, okay, hey, I'm from the CRP and I'm going to help you find your job. And they didn't really, their parents didn't really understand the process. They didn't really understand the process. And then it was just starting from scratch. So this allows us, again, this allows everyone to be identified a little bit earlier. You know, you might have started working with us in a school and decided you don't want to work with us in employment. Again, consumer choice, that's fine. We don't find that happening very often because we think we're pretty likable and pretty competent. But, you know, that is a choice. So that is at a bare minimum. The person gets training. Great, right? If you go to the next one. Okay, people become seen and part as a recognized workforce for the future. So that particularly with that work-based learning experience, sometimes when I work with employers, and I used to be I'd say I'm still a business person to a degree, but that's what I did. I owned a catering business and I did restaurants and that kind of thing. I wasn't ever planning to be in disability advocacy, and that happened out of necessity for my daughter. But I really studied it and I really wanted to do things you know, in a best practice way. And that's, I always tease my staff and I say, if nothing else, I hire really well. So, because I hire people that know more than me in other parts too. So when you get people out there in a work-based learning experience and now all of a sudden the employer sees, oh, wait a minute, that wasn't my idea of disability. Okay. What I was thinking is about the guy that I met back in high school, and they'll have like one single story about what that looks like. And so they start to see the capacity and that people have varied skills and strengths, just like everybody else, just like typical peers. If you hit it again, some will come up at the bottom there. Okay, well, yeah. So the next thing that can happen, seeing that now all these circles of support are coming together, right? So allies start uniting with the individual at an earlier age. If we have to go into a school to deliver pre-eds, guess what? We have to be talking with the teachers, with the schools, a lot of times with the administrators or the districts. Advocacy groups you'll see over there. That was one of the first places I went because I'm like, where are we going to find the students that we can serve? If parents don't know about it, then likely we won't, especially in a community-based class. So we started working more with advocacy groups. Of course, you have to work with Office of Vocational Rehabilitation and the Blind Services Division because they have to authorize for it. We started working with people with disabilities, with community leaders, peers, other providers. I mean, we do a lot of work, you know, in like the different associations around the state, and we try to be involved or have a presence in about everything when it comes to learning best practices. So that's another benefit of pre-eds. If you keep going, you'll see the circles get. Okay, so now all of a sudden, all of these people that are working together are going, wait a minute, that parent was right. There are barriers, okay? There are barriers to my student or my young adult being accepted into an integrated environment just without a barrier. Some of those are around perception, and we talked a little bit about this access. That's the big one. Expectations and esteem. I mean, I don't know if you've ever been and had this happen, but I've had teachers that have extremely high expectations of my child, and then I have some that have had no expectations of my child, and it makes a difference. It really does. You know, perception. What does the community think? Do they think that people with a intellectual disability can work? Well, if they don't, they need to come see us because we can show them plenty of examples of how that is not true. They can work, and they can be successful, and oftentimes make really, really good employees, again, given the right circumstances, the right conditions, the right facilitation. I think we all need that. So we start identifying those barriers and then kind of just breaking them down and attacking them from all these sides with all these different organizations and people. So keep going. Let's see. So these are the big ones that Haley and I just love, okay? Relationships are built, and that's the thing. When we would walk in that last quarter of their school, or sometimes, you know, it wouldn't happen even that smoothly. Like sometimes, oh, the school would forget to invite us, or you know, we would meet them after the fact and they'd had a bad experience with employment, and so they just didn't ever want to try it again. They might be 22 and they've been sitting, you know, on the couch for 4 years watching, you know, or doing social media and whatnot. So relationships are built, and that is so important to get to fill that gap. Leadership is recognized. That's because people are rising to the top in these team building activities like we were just talking about. The community is naturally educated. Instead of us telling them, they're seeing it. And then those gaps are closing. So you saw, we just kind of went through it really quickly, but at the least, they get training, or they get extra education around what it might be like to be an employee. But at the most, I mean, some of this stuff can start happening. And so I would, as a mother, I'm insistent that this happens for my child because she's eligible, and she's worthy of it, and she needs it, and she will benefit from it. And so I really like to see this happening. And actually, I just had a conversation with her school yesterday and they don't call it pre-ets there, but you know, she's going to do some work-based learning experience starting next year because it's a K through 12 school. So one of the hours that we talked about building into her vocational experience is working in the kindergarten class. And her teacher said, yeah, and not just in a token type of response, you know, activity. I mean, she could read to the kids, she could run a center. I don't know what the centers look like, but we're finding all that out. It's a new school to us. But again, high expectations versus low expectations. So we'll go to the go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I just had a conversation the other day on a on our Tuesday webinar about this exact thing with Johnny Collette, and he was talking about that exact thing. He was actually talking about, you know, we hear about achievement gaps all the time, you know, in the school setting, and then, you know, that leads to opportunity gaps, and then also then to exactly what you were saying was that expectation gap. And wow, when you were just talking there about that, it just kind of pulled all that together because that is so true. You know, when there are low expectations or even the, or even, excuse me, no expectations, then it limits the student, of course, from achieving anything. And eventually that's all they're going to think that they can do is what they can't do. So I love that, you know, that's what you all are focusing on and bringing that circle together. I love that visual, by the way. Love it.
Thank you. Haley, do you want to add anything there? Or do you, we'll see how you're...
I was just going to add that I feel like I have feedback again. I'm so sorry. That really the relationships piece is just so great, I think. I've been in some schools now for almost 4 school years with students. And so by the time it comes to where they're graduating, that student knows me and they know build inclusion because I have other staff that come with me to classes and help out with classes. And so it really helps that transition after they graduate. And they know the expectation, you know, or like they're learning that, hey, I'm going to go to work and it is something that I can do. And that's what the expectation is. And we're going to find something that I would like to do. It's not just placing people in different things. It's intentional, which is what I like. But it's also not only the relationship with the student, but we are also building relationships with those parents or other people in their lives too. And so there's a trust piece to that as well. I just think the relationships are so important and you learn so much from students during these classes. One benefit is yes, they get the training, but also, I mean, it's really us learning so much more about them. So when it comes to helping them and finding a job, we've seen them working with people. We've seen them in different situations already. And so sure, there's things that can come up that we probably wouldn't expect once they are in a job, but we already have an understanding of who that person is and what they like and what they don't like and what conditions are gonna need to be in place or supports are gonna need to be in place so they're successful. And that's really, you know, we want everybody to be successful that we work with and help that. So that relationship piece is just so important. It's one of my favorites. So,
right, that's so true. And you can go ahead to the next slide because I want people to have a chance to ask a question if they need to. But I do want to brag on Haley for a little bit too because she worked in one school for a couple of years, and there was a person in there that had not only kind of a significant impact of disability. We actually offer services in the moderate to severe, the what's called the MSD rooms in Fayette County. I don't know what it's called in every other county because it's a little bit different, but the rooms where people might be on alternate assessment, we haven't been afraid to go in there. We actually like to do that because we feel like there's another gap there with people with more significant impact of disability. So less expectation, less chance of being placed. So there was one person that not only was in that room, but she had, she was from a different country and there were communication barriers, and Haley stuck with it, with her family. And it us a couple of years to get her authorized for services, because clearly one of the job coaches that have worked with her one time said, oh, she can't do it because she, you know, she kind of had a bad experience. And we pushed, and Haley pushed, and she now is in customized supported employment, and she will get a job. And we know that. And the brother is pretty much the interpreter for the family, and they're just very grateful. And it's our pleasure. I mean, it's like we're grateful too, because we get to learn about this person who does have a lot of skills and talents and strengths. This next piece here is what's probably important to you all. So if anybody poses questions during this time, I don't know how exactly you do that, Stella, but that's great. But in my community, how do I access this as a student or a job seeker? It probably is being offered to some degree in your schools. I know that where I'm at, it hasn't been offered in the schools right now when it's all gone virtual. So you can also check with your Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, or if you know a provider in the area, and ask them if they are offering any kind of community classes. If you're in a Central Kentucky county, you can certainly call on us and we can try to help you get into one of our virtual classes. If you're not in a Central Kentucky county and you just have no other options, you know, there's always, we have kind of a philosophy, if we don't ask, then the answer is always going to be no. So it doesn't mean that we couldn't go to somebody to higher up and ask, could we possibly serve this person in this area, even though that's not traditionally on our list. And there have been times that we've done that. How do I advocate for this as a parent? If there's no pre-ets in your area, I would, again, be calling on the schools and saying, you know, this is a really great benefit that's out there that can be offered in multiple different ways. Would you please give somebody a call, whether it's somebody at OVR, or there is a pre-ets team established at the Office of Voc Rehab now. Dorothy Jenkins is a part of that, and Janelle Turner. But more informally, if they just want to get some information, we are happy to give them information. We're not trying to take the state over. We can't. I mean, we're a six-person group. You know, we're limited in what we can do, but we certainly would want to help other people get these services in their area. And so the final one, how do I deliver this as a provider? If you're not signed up to do pre-employment transition services, we are happy to walk you through the process. Again, VR has a process as well. I do know that if you're going to be doing group classes, which again, we feel like there's a lot of benefit to, you do have to submit a proposal. That's things we've helped people with in the past, and we would be more than happy to help in the future. Even if it's just giving a little bit of advice, all the way to helping to train and deliver curriculum. So really there's lots of ways to get this, but I do think that it's super, super important. And we do appreciate you asking us to come today, Stella. I know that doesn't leave much time for questions, but.
Oh, that's great. No, that's great. You probably covered some of those questions, actually.
I know it's a lot.
Yeah. Let me ask Michaela if there are any questions that anyone has asked out there. Michaela, can you hear me? She might not be able to hear me. I know one of the questions, I can tell you one of the questions that someone had, and this is kind of more of a school IEP question, but when can these services start and how can I ensure my child will get these in school, and do they need to be incorporated in their IEP?
Okay, so it's school to school. We can't tell a school what to do, right? We can just merely give them the information and tell them that these things are available and these are the people that offer them. So CRPs are one part of the puzzle. Co-ops are another. I don't know if they would write it into your IEP. I have never gotten it written into my daughter's IEP, but it could be part of I don't know why it couldn't be part of the vocational needs if they know that they're going to have it. I think that some of the schools don't have it just simply because they don't know about it and they don't understand how it works. And that would be the only way, the only thing that I can think of. But, you know, again, if you don't ask, the answer is always no. So ask.
That's right. That's good. How are, do you know how the co-ops are utilizing the services now? Because most of the time I know they did transition fairs, you know, face-to-face transition fairs. And since, you know, yeah, the world is different now, how are they utilizing, you know, during COVID, what do you know what some of the activities that they're doing now? Or how are you all doing it too?
Well, we're doing it through the virtual instruction, and we are in a couple of schools, but we, or probably three schools, is that right, Haley? But we're
in two right now.
Well, two, but we have multiple classes in some of them. Yeah. We put our resources more into the community base because we know that schools have just this limited amount of time within their virtual instruction, and so it just was really difficult. They were already trying to manage how am I going to work during COVID and that type of thing. So we just started concentrating on community and, you know, getting the word out to the VR counselors, getting the word out to our current population of people we were serving, getting the word out to parent advocacy groups, and then seeing who came on and who wanted to be a part of it. So I do not know what the co-ops are doing right now. I was talking to Haley about that yesterday. I just don't know how they're doing it. And so I don't want to speak for them, but I am going to be talking with the great ladies at the co-op here in Lexington next week. They're having a little kind of get together for a lot of people that we used to get together and do monthly meetings, and we knew everybody knew what everybody's doing. And that is the best way. Like if you have multiple providers in one school, if you have a CRP and you have the co-ops and you have KCTC, I mean, I've pushed for this for a long time, but having that communication about what everybody's doing, because everybody has some limitations on either time, what exactly they can do. Like, for instance, we can't take somebody out of a school and transport them somewhere else as a CRP, but a co-op can if it's worked out with the school and it's a certain number of people. But we have time where the co-op might have to serve 35 schools in a month, and they're all over the region, and they're driving from place to place to place. So they might only get 45 minutes once a month with somebody or with a particular school. So there are benefits, like I said, to having all of them. I'm 100% though, just constantly just driving home the that a CRP needs to be in there to be able to follow that student out of school. They just, in my opinion, that's what I would like to see. Again, you can't make the schools do that. You can encourage it, you can educate, and we do get a lot of good responses in that. But even sometimes the schools will say yes, and we'll be ready to go in, we'll have all the paperwork done, and then the administrator of the district come down and say, sorry, we're not going to do it that way. Just don't have a lot of control over that.
Yeah, I love what you said, you know, about following the student after school, because I really believe that that is a key right now, especially with our students, you know, all students, of course, but the ones with more moderate to severe disabilities, you know, a lot of times when they exit, we were looking at the youth 1 year out data yesterday and how those numbers are kind of alarming of how many are not involved, you know, with employment or doing things. And I think one way parents can really encourage that too is, you know, let your kid have some chores at home. So they start getting in that groove, you know, I mean, we, with Clayton, it was never an option. You're working, you're going to get a job, and, you know, we just made it, that's how life is, you're going to work. And so those skills, he began to develop early on. And I think families need to encourage that. But I love that you do follow, you know, after high school. I think that's so critical right now.
I think that's super important, because that one student that Annette talked about that I kind of stayed on, she would have fallen through the cracks if I hadn't, I feel like if we weren't in that classroom and knew about her, that she's someone that definitely would just be at home and not have any other options. So I really feel like that's super important. I'm just really glad that we finally get to work with her. So
low, you know, parents don't mean to do that. You know, we don't intentionally go, I don't, you know, I don't I want my child to think they can't do anything. We don't intentionally do that, but I think sometimes our overprotection enables them so much that we begin to not see their potential, because a lot of times we need somebody else from the outside to come in and remind us of the wonderful and great gifts and talents that they do have that we're sometimes blinded by, because we deal with so much of the other stuff on a daily basis. So I think that's awesome that Haley, you were able to be, you know, input into that little girl's life in order for her to be able, you know, to blossom and do what obviously she is very capable of doing. And so I think that's awesome. Well, I don't see any more questions right now, but it was great. I so appreciate you all joining us today and being a part. I know we had a little bit of technical difficulties every now and then, but I don't think we've had one webinar that we haven't had one. And I think in our world right now, when we're all going virtual, there's all kinds of stuff that can happen. But I just wanted to let everyone know that when you exit the webinar today, there will be an evaluation that will pop up. And if you'll just take a few minutes to complete that for us, let us know how we did today, maybe give some suggestions, and also maybe some suggested topics that you would like. We'll be scheduling our March and April webinars coming up real soon. So some topics that maybe you all would like to have us do on our Tuesday and Thursday. And thanks again, Annette and Haley. I really appreciate it. And everyone have a great day.
Thank you, Stella.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everyone. Bye. Thanks, Haley.